Yes, practice will be in here, and then our service will be over in the education building. It sure will be. Yeah, and we'll be they'll be practicing in here at 5 tonight. I didn't even mention that. I was talking about the one Friday night, and I didn't even mention the one tonight. So do that. Turn with me to 1 John chapter 4. Want to start off today with us listening to a song. This is not a church song. It's a song from 30 years ago. Some of you are going to know it. Some of you are going to want to sing along with it, okay? It's a reminder for those that know it. Those that don't know it, just listen to the words. I'm going to try, without interrupting, to give you a few, while we're listening to it, to give you some keys and cues, and then when we're done, we'll talk about it, okay? We're just going to listen to it a little bit. Play a little bit for us, Brandon.
It's not that I want to, not to say, but if you only knew how easy it would be to show me how you feel. More than words is all you have to do to make.
Who knows that song? Yeah, it's a good one. If you don't know, if you don't know it, I'll tell you this. Before we ever talk about the song, there's a Jack Black, Jimmy Fallon recreation of the music video. If you haven't seen that, that's a good one too. You should YouTube that one. But this song, so listen, saying I love you, that's not the words I want to hear from you. Do you know how easy it would be just to show me how you feel? It doesn't matter a whole lot that you tell me that you love me, right? Like if you tell me with your words that you love me, but your actions show me something else, we got a problem. If you want me to know that you love me, it's going to take more than words to show me how you feel. And then you won't even have to tell me because I already know, right? He knows it. He's jamming out over there. That one, he liked that one. I played this song because this is the idea of what it means for God's love to be made manifest to us. As we started looking last week at this idea kind of surrounding the Christmas story, this is probably a very doctrinal, this is a much more doctrinal look at the Christmas story than looking at the, you know, to go to one of the Gospels and talk about shepherds and wise men and all that sort of stuff. This is kind of a more doctrinal look at the Christmas story. But in 1 John, we come across this phrase over and over again, made manifest, that through Jesus Christ, God's, we talked about last week, His life was made manifest, His love was made manifest, light was made manifest to us in what He has done for us. Primarily, His love was made manifest for us when Christ died on the cross for me and you, right? And we talked about what was made manifest last week, right? This week, we want to focus in on this. We want to think about this week, where was it made manifest? When we start thinking about the love of God, where was the love of God made manifest to us? Because it was. Like, God did not just tell us with His words that He loved us. God has shown us that He loved us. He has demonstrated His love for us. Not only do we have it just in a book with pages that are written, right? But we believe this to be the Word of God, right? But He didn't just tell us with words. There was a demonstration in which He showed His love to us. It was more than words with which God showed to us. So we want to read in 1 John 4. We're going to start in verse 9. which is really a key verse. We read this verse last week. We read verse 9 alone last week, because this is kind of the verse I'm kind of the sermon series kind of centers around that. And that verse, but we're going to read more than verse 9 today. We're going to start in 9 and go through 14 and think about this idea, where was God's love made manifest to us? In 1 John 4 and verse 9, it says, "In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us and his love is perfected in us. By this, we know that we abide in him and he in us, because he has given us of his Spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world." Did you notice there in verse 4, it wasn't God's goodness that was made manifest to us. It wasn't his benevolence that was made manifest to us. It's God's love that was made manifest to us in Jesus Christ. Today I want to give you three places where you can see this, where you can see it made manifest, where you can see the love of God made manifest to us, right? Let's start in a very obvious place because of our season. Let's start by noting that this passage talks about that his love was made manifest in the cradle, or at his cradle, you find his love being made manifest. I don't know if you realize how big of a deal Christmas is in this sense. God being born among us in human flesh, right? Like this is all of God's glory. This is all of God's glory encapsulated in that little baby, right? In the person of Jesus Christ, right? God coming to live among us in the person of Jesus Christ and being born among us. If you think about that particular story in Scripture where the Mount of Transfiguration, remember where Jesus reveals himself to them? He reveals his glory, that Shekinah glory of God. He reveals it to those disciples on the top of the Mount of Transfiguration. All of that glory contained in this tender, tiny body. That's an amazing thought to me. There are a few songs that kind of get at that, right? You know, Mary, did you know? You know, that's the idea with Mary, did you know, right? Mary, did you know that this baby boy, that this, I like the one that's good, let's use this for example. Did you know that this child that you have delivered will soon deliver you? That's the idea. It's God in human flesh being born among us in order to redeem the world. And all of it encapsulated in this little fragile baby, right? Chris Rice has a song called "Welcome to Our World," and there's a great line in there. "Fragile fingers sent to heal us, tender brow prepared for thorn, tiny heart whose blood will save us, unto us is born, unto us is born." This is God being revealed in a baby. See, the passage talks about this. This is not just something that we have in song lyrics, right, surrounding this time of the year. The doctrinal thread that runs through this is here in 1 John 4 and 9. Look at what it says here. "In this, the love of God was made manifest among us." Okay, in what? "In that God sent his only Son into the world." Now, there's a phrase in there I want us to focus on for just a bit. If you're reading from a King James version, it uses a couple of words. It uses "only begotten Son." I'm reading from an ESV today, which uses the word "only." And I want us to talk about that for just a minute and maybe talk about why King James includes "begotten" and why ESV uses only, okay? Why it's only that word in there, right? This idea of begotten, sometimes we associate it sometimes with begetting, right? This is a problem. We associate it with begetting, like in the first part of Matthew, this dad beget this son, and this dad beget this son, and we almost have it in this idea that it was, that it's like to be born of, right? But this idea here, begotten, as it's used, and this is the only time that it is used in 1 John. John in his gospel uses it several times, right? Like, I don't have this one memorized. One place that you know that it's there is in John 3:16, right? The God, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son. This verse, I'm going to mess it up if I don't do it, if I don't read it. John 1:14, which is another verse we read surrounding Christmas. The word of God became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen his glory. Oh, this is a manifest verse too, isn't it? We've seen his glory, glory as of the only son, the only begotten son from the Father, full of grace and truth. So John uses this word often, right? But this word doesn't mean born, right? It's the idea of oneness or uniqueness. One of a kindness is a better way to think about begotten. So only is a really good definition. He's the only one. Jesus is the only one sent of God to redeem us in this way. And if you look at the passage, if you think about this idea that God, that Jesus wasn't begotten in the sense that he was, Jesus did not come into existence in a stable, in that cradle in Bethlehem. You understand? Jesus was not coming into existence at that moment. Jesus is God. God is eternal, right? So one of those attributes of Jesus, even when the Bible talks about it, you know, it doesn't say that God is the same. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. It's referring to that Jesus Christ, that second person of the Godhead, this idea of Jesus Christ being divine. He has been in existence from eternity past, right, with the Father. So it's not like he's being born into existence in Bethlehem, but he's being born into human flesh, into this world in that Bethlehem. And if you look at this passage, this uniqueness is seen even more, not so much in the word only or begotten, but I think it's the word that comes right before that. Let's talk about this for a minute. Look at how the passage says, it's in this that the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only son. Sent is an interesting word in that. I don't know that I've ever noticed it or realized it, but as I read that word, a few thoughts begin to come to me about that. You know, babies are not sent into this world. I don't want to shatter anybody's dreams here, okay? But in the sense that, what? Yeah, this crew over here. This crew. Don't want to shatter your dreams, Lake, but babies are not delivered by storks. I don't know if you know that or not, but they're not. And so this idea of being sent or delivered like this, you know, that Dumbo, you know, the Dumbo and all the babies, all the storks are delivering all the babies, you know, this idea, that's not the idea, right, to be sent into this world. You guys have heard me talk about, too, one of my favorite loony theories about religion is, you know, these radio all night radio shows where people call in and they talk about their weird ideas, and sometimes it's aliens and sometimes it's whatever else. Well, I remember one of those late night radio shows listening to this woman who believed that there was a machine on the moon. Do you guys remember me talking about this lady? She believes there's a machine on the moon, and it's essentially a reincarnation idea that the spirit of people is what gives the moon its illumination. She's serious about this, by the way, okay? And there's a machine there, and when a person dies, their spirit goes to the moon and is collected by this machine, and that's why the moon waxes and wanes, and it gets full of all of these spirits, and then when babies are born, this machine on the moon shoots those spirits back down here to Earth, and those babies are reincarnated. That's why, look, this is not crazy, people, because you know that a lot of babies are born on a full moon. Right? It's full. You got to get rid of them. Get them out there, right? And so you got to start shooting them out of the machine. And so this is like a, but when I read this week, I thought back to that lady, right? They're not sent by storks. Babies aren't sent into this world, right? They're born into this world. They're not sent by storks. They don't come from a machine in the moon. Listen, I'm going to tell you. I have heard in a Bible study with Christian people, I have heard someone talk about in death going back to the Father. Like you and I existed with Him before we were born. No, no, no. That's not me and you. That what I just shared with you, is very silent about that. We don't laugh about that as much. But that's a Christian kind of idea that floats around in some people. It's like a Christian version of the machine on the moon or a stork theory, right? You and I did not exist before, in my case, January 6, 1981. I didn't exist before then, right? I didn't exist before then. Christ existed in eternity past. The Bible tells us that He was the Lamb that was slain before the foundations of the world. That being the case, He was more than just born into this world. He was sent into this world. And this idea of being sent is, look at the passage with me. We read it in 9, but if you'll think about what we read in total, look at where you find it, 9. That God sent His only Son into the world. Look at verse 10. But that He loved us and sent His Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Look at verse 14. We have seen and testified from the Father that He has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. This idea is, it's more than Him just being born into the world. It's a missional idea. That Jesus was sent into this world. Born of a virgin to live a sinless life. And to seek and save that which was lost. It was missional in that sense, right? For God to demonstrate and show His love to us. And in this sense, Jesus is unique. Where was it made manifest? It was first made manifest in His cradle when God sent His Son into this world, right? But let's move secondly to this. It was made manifest at His cross. So made manifest at His cross. We didn't sing it. Well, some of us sang it. But we listened to that song a while ago, More Than Words, right? This idea that God used more than words to show us His love for us, that is a biblical idea. It is almost verbatim, Romans 5 and verse 8, that God demonstrated His love to us in this, that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. At His cross, there was a demonstration of His love for me and you. It was at the cross where Jesus took away our sins. He destroyed the works of the devil, made them inoperative in the life of the believer. And when you read the Bible, what becomes very clear, when you go back to the Old Testament, and I quoted that verse a while ago, that Jesus Christ was the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. This idea of Jesus dying on the cross was not an accident. It wasn't something that just happened through happenstance because Jesus made some people mad. This was the plan from the beginning. From the first few chapters in Genesis, you see hints of it. From the law in the Old Testament and the pictures, what's symbolized in the ritualistic law of the Old Testament, it's pointing to it. Jesus Christ knows it when He comes. It's in the prophecies about before His coming, right? And Jesus speaks about it when He comes. John the Baptist says, "Behold, the Lamb of God slain," right? Behold, the Lamb of God. Look at Him. The Lamb of God. This is a Lamb, a sacrifice that was slain for us. This idea that Jesus Christ came. This was not an accident. Jesus even said to Himself, you remember we talked about before in Mark 8, 9, and 10, Jesus tells the disciples, I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to be betrayed. They're going to kill me on the cross, but I'm coming back. This is not an accident. This was an appointment, right? Jesus said this, right? They don't take my life from me. I lay my life down freely. And not only do I just lay my life down freely, because there's people that do that all the time, right? There's people that give themselves, sacrifice themselves, right? Even if you listen, we were talking in Sunday school last week. I don't know if I mentioned it out here, but we were talking in Sunday school last week about in defending our faith about Jim Jones and drinking the Kool-Aid and all that. And if you listen to that recording while they're all committing mass suicide, he's saying to them, this is not a violent suicide. This is not a destructive suicide. This is a revolutionary statement. But you know what's different between the sacrifice of Jesus laying down his life and those at Jonestown laying their life? Jesus said, not only do I lay my life down, I got the power to take it back up again. This is uniqueness. This is a difference, right? Jesus Christ is born into this world with the mission of seeking and saving that which was lost. If you look at the passage here, this idea of in verses 9 and 10, you really find it in 9 and 10, that God, this missional idea that he came, 9 gives one reason, 10 gives another. Let's talk about each of them very quickly, okay? In 9, notice that God sent his only son into the world so that we might live through him, so that we may have eternal life, so that the light of his love may shine into us and we may have eternal life. But then look at verse 10. In this verse, it says that he sent his son to be the propitiation for our sin. That's a churchy word. Have you ever used the word propitiation apart from reading the Bible? So what is it? So ESV use King James uses propitiation, so does ESV. Now, if you find another, in fact, when I am looking for something that's relatable, like a translation to use from the pulpit that's accurate and trustworthy and understandable, ESV, one of the reasons that I landed on ESV is because ESV still uses the word propitiation, right? And I like that. Other translations might use something else. They're not bad words to use to translate it. They just don't fully give the idea. So like some translations might use the idea of substitute, right? That Jesus substituted, that he died in our place, that we were condemned to death because we had broken the law of God, and Jesus was our substitute on the cross. He died in our place. And that sort of conveys the idea, but not really. Some translations use the idea of sacrifice, that God sent his son as a sacrifice for our sins. And that's true too. I mean, that conveys kind of the idea that you see in the Old Testament, this idea of kind of that's the sacrifice died in the stead of the person who had committed the sin. That's sort of that idea. But here's the idea of propitiation. It adds another element. It's this idea that he died in our stead to satisfy the wrath of God. That's what's really important about propitiation, about what's conveyed in that word, is the idea that it's not just a substitute. And while sacrifice kind of gives that, propitiation really zeroes in on this idea that it's not just in our stead, but it is in our stead. He died in our stead to satisfy the wrath of God. See, when we look at the cross, what we find in this is that prior to our coming to Christ, when we read the Bible, when we look at how the Bible presents us and our journey, that where Christ draws us from sin, rescues us from darkness, and brings us to marvelous light, this is how that happens. Prior to coming to Christ, we were dead in our trespasses and sins. We talked about that last week, right? And because we were dead in our trespasses and sins, we had broken God's law, we had made ourselves enemies of God. The Bible says we're at enmity with God in that way, right? What we have done has set us, like our thoughts and our actions and our deeds, in our sin, we are the opposite of God's holy nature, right? So in our sin, the way it looks is God is right and righteous, and we are wrong and sinful. It's the opposite of that, right? But here's the thing. Even though in that moment he is right and righteous and I am wrong and sinful, and so there's this separation. I'm an enemy of his because God is just and righteous, and those, it doesn't mix, right? sinful man and holy God. But in that moment, the Bible tells me that while I'm there, even though I'm at enmity with God, do you know what? God loves me. In fact, that verse that we talked about in Romans 5 and verse 8 says, God demonstrated his love in this, while we were yet sinners. While we are wrong and sinful, he loves us. What we find at the cross of Calvary is this, that our sin demanded justice. And he's a just God, right? A justness, a rightness is one of his attributes. In fact, I was explaining this to somebody the other night. This is how I describe that idea that God is a just God and you want a God who punishes sin, right? We might think about, oh, no, I would rather have the grandfather doting kind of God. You know, no, you want a God who punishes sin. And this is what I mean by that. If I were to go down here to the MAPCO and I were to walk in there with a gun and stick it in their face and say, give me all your money and all your Reese cups. This is how I tell this story, right? No. They're good, but I want the Reese cups. And a few Kit Kats for Lake are out here getting it, you know? And so then I leave the MAPCO, and the cops are on my trail, you know? And I'm driving down Highway 95, and I'm flying as fast as I can go. There's money blowing out the window. There's Reese cup wrappers out the window. And I'm flying down the road, and I crash through a mailbox and into your living room, and I kill your children, your mom, your grandmother. And then I stand before the judge, and the judge says to me, now, do you promise you'll never, ever do this again? Yes, sir, I promise. Okay, Mr. Brown, you're free to go. Is that judge a good judge? Because justice hasn't happened, right? And so if we take a God who says, oh, this sin that's so opposed to my nature, that's so against like I am, look, don't you even worry about that. Let's just sweep it under this rug and don't even look at it. Is that the God we want to serve? Is that a just God? So if he's going to be a just God, he's got to do something with our sin. There's got to be this rightness, this right punishment for our sin. And the Bible says that the wages of our sin is, it's the only right punishment. It's the only right punishment. But you see, also, it's not just that God is just, but it's also God is love. And you see, he can't deny one part of him for the other. And so this idea of his love is demonstrated to us in that Christ comes and dies for us. That's why we love Jesus so much. Jesus is our propitiation. He is the means by which we are saved, but much more than that, he is the propitiation that satisfies God's wrath, that meets God's requirements for justice, and at the same time, meets his requirements for love. This is what's made manifest at the cross, that Jesus himself is sent to us in order to satisfy God's requirements for love and for justice. I've totally skipped over, but let me read them to you because they're good, okay? I should just wrap it up there, but I'm not because these are good. This is a couple of commentators and how they would talk about that too. So listen, they give a couple of different takes, which is good for us. Adam Clark says this, the whole world was sentenced to death because of sin, and every individual was dead in trespasses and sins. And Jesus came to die in the stead of the world and quicken every believer that all might live to him who died for them and rose again. Homiletic commentary. The very conditions of the incarnation, that's a big churchy word too, but it's just the idea of God being born in human flesh. Jesus coming and living among us. That's the incarnate. He was God incarnate among us. The very conditions of the incarnation necessitated the crucifixion. The path from Bethlehem to Calvary was a straight one marked out by God himself. The point is, Jesus manifested the love of God on the cross by being the propitiation for my sin and for yours. You see it in his cradle and you see it on his cross, but let's look lastly. The final place that you see his love made manifest is in his Christians. In his Christians. Love the love of God is a great thing, but you understand that if you simply love God, that doesn't make you saved, right? We're not saved by loving God, right? We're not saved by loving others or doing good things for others. As we were watching the video earlier, everything that those missionaries are doing in that country that will remain nameless to those nomadic people, it's all establishing a pattern for credibility, and it's showing the love of God in order to be able to share the gospel. The giving of coal, the giving of water, of resources, of replacing those burned yurts or giving that hay. All of those things, there's nothing specifically, we're going to talk about this some tonight, there's nothing specifically evangelistic in that, right? That's missional. It's a mission. It's missions in the sense that it's leading to evangelism, right? And so you and I are not saved by giving hay away and coal away and replacing burnt yurts. It's not just by being good to others or whatever. That's not. We're saved by belief on Him. And once that happens, once there's this faith in Him, then the result becomes love to others. 1 John really deals with this a whole lot. In fact, what we have read right now deals with it a whole lot. This truth is that men, we do not naturally love God. We only love God because God has first loved us. Right? Verse 10 says so much. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that He loved us. And then He sent His Son to die on the cross. Do you understand what happens in that? Is that we've talked a lot about salvation for the believer. And I would say this to you today. If I share that idea about coming to Christ and I talk about His death on the cross and how He paid the penalty for us there, if you're here today and you've never experienced the relief and the security in Him of knowing that that sin issue has been dealt with in your life, you need to come when the service is over and see that, right? The whole reason we're here today. It's because that's happened in our own life. We praise Him for that and to call others to respond to that love, right? But if you look in verse 12, it gets to this idea that it's not just that we experience the privilege of salvation through what Jesus has done, but once God's love has been shown to us, once God's love has been made manifest to us, it is incumbent on us to then make God's love made manifest to this world, to make manifest His love to others. And you see it in verse 12. No one has ever seen God. Let's stop right there. We talked about this morning in Sunday school, this idea, if your lesson was like mine, this idea of that God is there and what is His, how would we say that God exists? How would we contend for the faith in speaking to someone who doesn't believe that God's even there? How would we reason through that? Or what evidences would we give? Where would we point them in Scripture? How would we describe and define our faith in God, because I've never seen God, right? No one's seen God. But I know He abides in me, right? Like I've been given His Spirit. Verse 13 says that we know that we abide in Him and He in us because He's given us His Spirit. I've felt the convicting power of His Spirit. I've felt the enlightening power of His Spirit. I've seen how He opens my eyes to spiritual things. So, like this idea that His Spirit is living in me, that's true. And so in verse 12, I haven't ever seen Him, but if we love one another, then God abides in us. This God abiding in us will produce a love for one another. And then there's this phrase, and His love is perfected in us. And when you read that, you could come to this conclusion. You could misinterpret that and say, ah, that means God's love that He gives to us is imperfect. And He needs to give that love to us in order that that love might be perfected. That's not what that verse is saying, right? The idea of that, of perfected, is the same idea that kind of goes along with this idea of made manifest, that it's made realized, it's made actualized. So the idea that the perfected could really be a good definition of that is that it reaches its goal. That's the idea. You see, the Son of Man came to seek and save that which was lost. He came and demonstrated His love for us. He came and wanted to show His love. We were sinners in need of redemption. Therefore, when the sinner is redeemed, the goal is met, and God's love is perfected in that. And because he has shown us his sacrificial love, it should be our heart to show that to others. Just like verse 12 says, no one has ever seen God. And we know that when we read in the book of Hebrews, for example, it says that God has spoken to us. God has shown himself through the prophets. God has shown himself through creation. God has shown himself through the thing. He's shown it through Jesus Christ in these latter days. But Jesus Christ is not walking the earth doing miracles, preaching the gospel. So if they're going to see the demonstration of love, where will they see it? He's called you and I to be his hands and feet to this world, to live out this love. We're going to talk more about this next week, this idea that his love in us is a witness to this world. It shows this world that what has happened in us is genuine, and it's reflecting God's love that he has shown to us, to others. It is the, in this age, it is the only demonstration, live action demonstration of God's love. We can look to the words of Scripture. We can look to what Jesus did on the cross. But living it out right now, and I'm going to tell you right now, we live in a world where love needs to be made manifest. Right? We started this message with a secular song about the need for someone to show me love, right? I'm going to give you another cultural commentary here. Listen to these words. Do you know anybody that this could be their testimony? I was alone then, no love in sight. I did everything I could to get me through the night. Don't know where it started or where it might end. I'd turn to a stranger, just like a friend. Some of you know, because I was looking for love in all the wrong places, right? You see, there's a lot of people that are looking for this. They know, as we took Cliff, as you were talking about this morning in Sunday school, they know there's something in them, right? There's this restlessness in them because they were made for God. And they have not experienced that love, right? God's made it manifest to us. God's made it manifest to us. And it's incumbent upon us to take that message of his love demonstrated on Calvary, shown to us in the cradle of Christmas, and share it with a world that needs him, right? This, if you were to have called me last night and say, what is your message about? This is the sentence that I would have shared with you. Love originated in God. It was manifested in his son, and it's demonstrated by his people. Did you hear me? Let me say that one more time. Love originated with God. It's manifested in his son, and it's demonstrated by his people. With your heads bowed and your eyes closed, as they come with a hymn of invitation, think on this for just a moment. Are you here this morning? And that empty feeling of looking somewhere for peace with God, peace in that area of what am I going to do about my sins? A weight of guilt and shame. God has made manifest to us today in the passage that we read in 1 John. He has made manifest a recipe for that. God says to you this morning, long before the cradle of Christmas, I had a plan in place. It's a plan to send my son into this world to be the propitiation for your sin. I don't want you to struggle with it anymore. I want you to surrender your will to mine. I want you to give yourself to me. Surrender wholeheartedly. Let me show you my love so that you can show my love to others. If he's speaking that to you today, I'm going to ask you to come. Let somebody pray with you, share with you, talk to you. Using Scripture, sharing from Scripture. We don't do anything here without going back to the standard of God's Word. I would say this, though, to you. Maybe you're here today and this idea of you maybe are thinking back over the last week, you're thinking back over this particular time or that particular time, and you're recognizing that as a believer in Christ Jesus, you understand what I'm talking about when I talk about this doctrine of salvation and His atoning work in our life, but you're not quite sure that your life makes manifest the love of God. Listen, we can do nothing apart from Him. And so some of you here today may just need to simply surrender to Him and say, Lord, I'm not able to do this on my own. It is outside of my ability to be able to manifest your love, reflect your love properly to this world. Maybe you need to come and confess that, confess other things. And just talk to God about that. We're not here this morning to put anybody on the spot or embarrass somebody or to draw attention. We're here this morning to help you take your next step to Jesus. Lord, we thank You that You have given Your Son. We thank You that You have shared this beautiful redemption message with us, that we are not without hope, that we are not without life or light or love, that we have those things in You. We praise You for that. And Lord, I pray for boldness for the one who is here today that doesn't know You but is struggling with a response to You. Someone that's watching this service. Lord, I pray that You would help them to respond to You in spirit and in truth today. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand together and sing.